Hello, it's Janice from Rue de Fleurs. Welcome back into the garden for our March 2024 Embroidery Garden Journal. Inspiration from the garden to inspire our embroidery. So this month in March, I am going to be doing daffodils. They're one of the first flowers that come up in my garden every year. And they're so sunny and bright and cheerful. So I'm just gonna take a few minutes and pick through my floss collection and kind of get out all of the golden yellow tones that I have, and then I will edit from there. So I'm just kind of pitching everything out, and then my inspector is coming to monitor my work today. And she gets her little legs up here, and then we are going to get started.
Okay, so for the battlement couching, Sarah recommends four colors in sort of a gradient. So that's what I'm going for. For my petals, I have a darker, sort of these medium bright, a little bit lighter yet, and then this very pale one. So that will be my darkest, medium, next medium, and then the lightest layer. For the inside of my cup, just to give a little bit more dimension, I have this range of more orange colors. And then for the outside of my cup, so this layer here, I have this range down here of colors. So the cup will be more orange compared to what my actual daffodil looks like, but I think that will allow it to have the effect that I'm going for. So I have a couple more than what I really need because I'm trying to use up some of these that just have a few little threads on them. If I can, I'm going to start with those, but then if I run out, like, see, I have these two that are essentially the same and these couple that are the same. So yeah, I'm gonna lay them out in order. And then I'm going to get started stitching my daffodil.
Okay, so I sort of jumped in the middle there, but let me go back and sort of clarify what I was talking about. I am going to try battlement stitching today, or battlement couching, which is basically like a lattice embroidery stitch where you layer a grid work of threads on top of one another, and then you secure them down over with one little top stitch, which is the couching actually. I watched a really great YouTube tutorial the other day on how to do this, and I will link that down below. The tutorial I watched was on the Sarah's Hand Embroidery channel here on YouTube, and I will link that. It was excellent and very easy to follow, only like 10 minutes. I also saw the needleandthread.com version if you prefer to read things, and I will link that as well. But basically, battlement couching is a series of layers of thread crossing over each other. So a vertical and then a horizontal layer. And then, like I said, you tack them all down. And I really wanted to use that effect here because I wanted a little bit of that frilly look of the daffodil petals. I also wanted something that I thought might be a quick filler stitch that I had never tried. So I looked up, you know, like cool filler stitches for embroidery, and I came across battlement couching, and I had never tried that before, so I thought I would give it a go at this time. So you need, Sarah recommends about four colors. You can do, you know, a little bit less if you want more of your fabric to show through, or you can do maybe one more would have worked in the amount of distance that I left between my grid stitches, but I probably wouldn't have been able to fit anything else. So I chose four different colors like she did in the tutorial, And then I also worked from dark to light like she did in her tutorial. And I really was pleased with the way that it turned out. It was very simple. And I unraveled a lot of thread. I thought I would use a lot of thread to do this, but it ended up not taking very much. It actually felt like it took less than a satin stitch. So if you are trying to fill in a large area, like, you know, daffodil is sort of a large flower, and I really zoomed in on it this time. I really played with perspective. Since last time I had the crocus and I did like the entire delicate little thing, including the bulb and like roots, I don't want my sampler to have the same perspective every single time. I think that would feel really boring. So this time I really wanted to focus on a little bit tighter viewpoint of the flower. And I really zoomed in on just doing basically the head of the daffodil, and then there's a tiny bit of stem and a little partial leaf that you'll see towards the end. But I really wanted the main focus this time to be on the flower itself. So I really needed a big filler stitch, and this battlement couching, I think, fit the bill. So like I said, I started with a darker, like peachy orange coral color as my bottom grid, and I spaced my grid lines about a quarter inch apart. No, I did not measure, but I just eyeballed. I'm pretty good at eyeballing a quarter inch because I quilt all the time. And so you do two for the space I had. I started with a sketch of my flower like I do every single time, and I just spaced about a quarter, trying to get at least two lines in that section so I could create the grid framework. So I had those two vertical lines and then two horizontal lines. And then, as Sarah describes, while you're stitching, you just ever so slightly come to the inside with the next color. So you either will go slightly to the right or slightly to the left, depending on how you want to layer yours, and then slightly to the top or slightly to the bottom on the horizontal. She describes it very well. But you want to offset your threads a little bit so you can see each layer and they build on top of one another. But you still want them closely packed together so that you're not having space in between each thread. So you get that shading effect, and it's really quite beautiful. So like I said, so I chose a darker color and then tried to find something that was the next step up from that for my next layer. And I put those just right to the left, like one stitch length next to it, not even a stitch length, just coming up right next to it and going down right next to it on the verticals. And then I came up above my last color and down right into, next to it, and then the same for this. So right up above the last row I had put in and right down on top of it to create this beautiful deep orange center of my cup, which I really felt like it gave my cup a lot of depth. And then to couch it, you come up over only your last little layer and where they cross, where they intersect, and you put a little tiny stitch straight up from the bottom and then straight down over that intersection. And that is the couching, and that's what holds the whole thing in place. So all of the layers are then tacked down one on top of another just by those tiny little over stitches that you do on your very last layer. And that's it. And so then I am going to speed it up really fast here and do the rest of the cup of my daffodil using the next brightest orange and yellows that I had in my collection. So they're a little bit more golden orange tones, and to the yellow. And it really actually obviously doesn't go as fast as this, but it is a very quick stitch. It doesn't really take very much time, and I think it is an excellent, like I said, sort of frilly appearance that worked really well for the daffodil. If you see them in real life, obviously they have, the cups can be quite frilly, I think mine are just like the old standard ones that you find in everybody's garden, basically, in North America. But you can get some really tricky looking ones. I know there's a whole daffodil society. So, you know, if you love it, go for it, right? But anyways, mine are just like the very traditional orangey yellow cup and then bright yellow petals. And I did a couple of petals that are on the bottom and then to the side. And then I am now working on the outer petals to the top and that kind of go behind. So a little bit for the petals, I think I still really like the effect. And I still really think that it filled them in nicely. But it was harder to get sort of like the proportion correct with the petals and having them not just be like flat looking, you know, which is kind of part of the challenge of this, is not really, you know, like I've never done this stitch before, so I wasn't 100% on how it was going to turn out. I might go back at the end and do an outline stitch all around my petals just to give them a little bit more definition, because you can see there maybe it's a little too loosely defined on the outside of the petals. But overall, I was very pleased with this, and I would definitely try this technique again. Like I said, it was very simple to do. If you read through the needle and thread tutorial, or if you watch the Sarah's Stitching Embroidery Channel description of this, it was super easy to follow. I just think you would have to watch your stitch length. I don't know that you would want to make your threads like too long. I think hers moved around a little bit more than mine, just because she covered a slightly larger area, and mine were all like relatively short, less than an inch lengths, even on my longest threads. But I had no trouble with it whatsoever, and I love the lattice grid look to the filling stitch. I mean, this might be a new favorite, so I definitely will be trying it again. And then I am just about ready to move on. And you can see that it does make an impact, and it does look very frilly. Then to create the stem and the leaf, I wanted those to definitely be more secondary on this piece, because I felt like I really focused on the branch for the juniper and then the entire flower for the crocus that I did. So this time I was really focusing more on the flower itself, and the stem and the leaf there are just very much supporting character. I used the kind of like a combination stem stitch, satin stitch, and just filled in the stem all the way up to where it came right to the base of my petals. And then I did go back with a contrasting bright green on the other side of it. And I don't know, I wasn't like super happy. So I did end up picking some of those out and starting over. I don't know if my alignment really was what I wanted on that, but it's fine. I'm not going to stress. Like, I'm not going to pick everything out, but I did pick a few out and start over. And then now I am just finishing my title, which again, I'm using very simple uppercase font and a plain backstitch. I used the very bright green that I used for the highlight on the stem and petal there. And yeah, I'm just filling that in to title my piece. You can see I'm missing the divider, like stem twig elements. I did go back later in the day and fill those in. I just didn't film it. And I just wanted to kind of get cracking with this first thing in the morning. So I went back later after my lunch break, and I filled those in. So they're there now, and you'll see them, I guess, in April. But yeah, overall, I'm really, really happy with how my stitching for this month came out, and trying something new. That's kind of the point of this whole exercise. I hope that you take a little time to try something new yourself and feel inspired to be a beginner, you know, get out there and stretch your little embroidery stitching wings, because it's kind of fun. And I think overall, the collection is more than the sum of any one part, right? So if I don't like every single element or every single thing that I tried, it's okay, because I'm learning something. And at the end of the year, not only am I going to have a beautiful representation of my garden, I'm also going to have a beautiful representation of my growth as an embroidery artist. And that's sort of the point, along with, you know, just the documentation. So here are a couple of the tips that I mentioned, and some close-ups of how that battlement couching looks, and my inspiration little daffodil there. So happy spring to you all, and I hope that you enjoyed today's video and it helped inspire you to be more creative in your embroidery practice. Make sure that you like and subscribe and follow along, hit the bell so that you don't miss anything. See you in the next one. Thanks.